Good morning, folks. How's everybody doing? See lots of stuff in the chat going on there. Some weather alerts going on. Oh, it's Joe says it's warm and sunny in the UK, which just seems wrong. Joe, I don't believe you. That's got nothing to do with the UK, warm and sunny. That's not what you guys do. Ah, so it's a Wednesday morning again. Brent is on vacation, second week in a row. What a lazy guy. So it's just myself and our guest, Ann Rollins, joining me this week. Ann's joining us from Denver. And as I tone down the music here, give us a little introduction to yourself, because it's your first time joining us here on IDIODC, isn't it?
I've been here a couple of times, but it's been a while. It's quite some time since before the world changed last year. Mm. Yeah, so hi, guys. So my name is Ann Rollins, and I am a solutions architect with the Ken Blanchard Companies. My role there is to really kind of bring a really great toolbox of learning theory and approaches and innovative technology to help our clients be able to deliver world-class leadership development experiences. Before I was at Blanchard, because a lot of people go, leadership development? Why are you here? What are you talking about? Innovation? What's that about? Before I was at Blanchard, I worked for one of the largest training and development companies, leading their instructional design capability, over 120 instructional designers around the world. And so I had a strong focus on learning innovation and bringing the technology that we use outside of work, inside of work, and kind of figuring out how that fits into the learning picture. So that's a little bit about me. So I'm glad to be here. Yeah.
Very cool. Yeah. And our official topic today is moving from event-based training to learning journeys. And I mean, we're all, I think, familiar with event-based training. You know, oh gosh, we showed up for a class, we sat in a room, and people gave us a bunch of stuff to think about or to learn, et cetera. Or maybe we took a singular e-learning course out of the LMS, that kind of a thing. Let's talk about why, starting there, why that maybe doesn't meet the needs that we need to sometimes achieve.
Yeah, for sure. Well, you know, things certainly changed last March, of course, but prior to that, the mandate and things were moving in this direction that, you know, we've got to be able to find ways to deliver first moment of learning and second and third moments of learning. And it's not so easy to bring people back into the classroom or bring people into a formal learning event every time that needs to happen. So there was already so much energy around how do we create truly a learning experience that allows our learners to learn, whether it's from an instructor or to do it in a self-directed way? But the things that are happening along the way after the first moments of learning have passed, to be able to work learning, meaningful learning, into the flow of work in a way that is connected and cohesive, and that allows them to apply what they've learned, to be able to reflect on what they've done, what worked, what didn't, maybe learn from others. Right. And then to be able to kind of refine their approaches and to be able to do some self-serve as well, to be able to get different support and resources they might need in that moment of need as they're out there doing the work. And so that energy had already really, there was this upwelling. But the big question is, what does it look like actually? And how do we get it done? Right. And so we spent a lot of time at Blanchard really kind of dialing in so that we can leverage our clients' current technology and find those sweet moments and help them create an experience that happens over time. Yeah.
Very, very cool. Yeah. I mean, I think of, you go to a, whether it's a webinar or a, you know, a session or whatever, something like that, and you come away with a sense of inspiration, but how much do you actually then transfer forward? How much do you actually retain? In a lot of ways, they'll share, parallels with cramming for an exam, right? You fill up, you get rid of it or whatever, but how much of it sticks with it? How much of it moves to long-term retention, et cetera? So it sounds like the journey is a strategy for, well, certainly for improving upon that, I would say.
Yeah, for sure. And you'll hear me talk about kind of the tools in our toolbox at Blanchard, but I want everybody on this call to be thinking about what are the tools that are in your toolbox that you could leverage to be able to create some of these experiences. We can also, before the end of our time, Our session, my session at ATD 21 next month, really focuses on basically taking legacy content and making it appropriate for a modern serve up. So that's definitely a part of it because it's a big part of the question. So we've got how we've always done it. We need to do something different. What is that middle space, and how can I actually take the steps to start kind of transitioning my content so that it works for a modern audience? But so the way we think about it in our toolbox, first moments of learning, and it might be face-to-face because face-to-face is coming back for a number of our clients. I mean, certainly on the bell curve, it's not the big part. It's VILT and digital. But really it's thinking about how we take that formal moment of learning, perhaps wrap around some micro learning bursts that happen afterwards that really build and extend on what they learned in that event-driven space, right? Or that formal moment of learning, possibly some leader conversations that we give them really good prompts, and then perhaps some group coaching that brings groups back together after the formal moment of learning. We have completed some micro learning, perhaps read some very, very deliberately curated content that kind of builds and extends, give them something to do with it, get them in touch with their leader and get connected about what they're doing and learn from their leader, and then bring them back in groups. And so we found that approach is really helps us to pull through what we call kind of the golden threads that make it so that we leave with inspiration from, say, our virtual instructor-led training course that we took, but that's just the beginning. That's not the end. And so that's kind of the way we're approaching things and thinking about it. It's really, you know, kind of the long game, because the longer they're building and applying and hearing from others what they're doing that works that they haven't thought of, it really makes a big difference.
Mm-hmm. I was just thinking about a team building session that in a previous career, the entire company, was in a hotel conference room for the afternoon, 60 or 80, people. And lots of stuff about soft skills and things about, lots of great information, but then there was literally nothing after that. The company had taken the entire staff, pretty much, except for maybe the three people who needed to stay and answer phones or something,
Right.
And put all that money, all that investment into that afternoon, and time, et cetera. And then, whatever came of what we talked about and did that day.
Yeah. And that's something too, that is so important to think about. We've got some big things happening on planet Earth, in these last 18 months. And as L&D professionals, I have said, this is our moment to really shine, to really help organizations achieve breakthrough results. But in order to do that, we've got to be laser focused and connected to our strategic objectives. What are the big things where we want the levers that we want to move, right? And then working it back from there into what are the behaviors that are going to move that needle. From the behaviors, it's what are the skills that people need to be able to perform in that way. And from the skills, then it's the learning that results from that. That's the starting point. If we can't prove the impact of the work that we're doing, that is a career limiting move more than ever right now. Because that is an expected, very clear line of sight. What did we spend? What did we get out of it? And so measurement becomes an important part of that. But also I think about, the critical nature of weaving in, I talk about these gold threads. What we're seeing global organization after global organization, inclusion and belonging as this absolute drumbeat that must be present throughout. And if you bring everybody together and run them through and exploring unconscious bias experience, and they go through maybe a virtual session or two, or they complete some e-learning, if there's not that rigor around it where people are coming together and really talking about what are the things that are happening in our organization today that actually deteriorate our capability to have a truly inclusive workplace where people belong. And so it's where those conversations is where the rubber hits the road. First moment of learning is great. That's where a lot of investment is focused today. but really thinking about how do we draw that conversation out? Because it's not point in time either. It's evolutionary. And if we want to be able to move the scale on how inclusive of an organization and a work culture that we've created, that needs to be absolutely a recurrent theme that happens over time. It doesn't flash in a pan and go away. You're checking boxes and you'll be looking for another job. Yeah.
And you know, behavioral change doesn't take place after one session. It's an incremental thing. It's an ongoing thing. It needs to be, it needs to involve self-reflection. It needs to involve outside observation as well.
Yeah.
Maybe we could, you brought some things to show us here. Maybe we could flip over to something there and you know, give us a bit of, I guess, some visual structure to what
Sure. So when I am working with a client, typically I'll be on kind of first call. And so think about as your L&D practitioner, when you are getting kind of the learning requirements that are coming in from your clients. At Blanchard, we use kind of what I would call a design thinking light type of an approach. And are you able to see my screen, Chris?
Yep, totally.
Perfect. Awesome. So looking at this is kind of a simple framework, kind of a design thinking light, but we really focus in on this empathize and define before we get to what could a solution look like, really. And so I'm going to be focusing on who we're solving for and what are we solving for. And so I'm not going to spend a ton of time here, but I wanted to show these are kind of the steps that we follow at Blanchard to build out these experiences that happen over time. This is foundational work. The ideate is where we start thinking about what could a journey look like. And so let me show you kind of the initial artifact that I build for our clients is a sample persona. And this is Elise. And for my client, I'm going to go and do some research on who are the people doing the job. She's a new leader. I'm going to scan kind of the job openings, really get close because I'm external. So I don't have easy access to just say, you know, what is the new leader's experience look like? Maybe more than a few questions in an initial call with a client. So I'm doing a little bit of homework here. But, you know, from her personality profile and thinking about the what she brings into work and her goals, her technology usage and aptitude, I'm able to derive kind of the preferred learning methods that chances are going to land well with Elise, right? And so from here, you know, I'm going to take this and understanding that for when we come into an engagement, we're going to look at more than just Elise. We're going to look at other folks who are like Elise doing similar work. But for the purpose of example, you know, I'm going to build this out and I've actually got a template and I'm wondering, Chris, if after this, are we able to share some files? Because these are templates that we share often.
Yeah, we definitely can. We have a LinkedIn group so we can share them there.
Oh, I love that.
If folks want to find that, I did put a link to the LinkedIn group at the top and I'll paste it in at the end of the chat.
But perfect.
That's a great way for us to share things for sure. And we also do a follow-up blog post on the dominKnow website, so we can include a link to that stuff there too.
I love it. So, you know, a sample template that you can use if you've not built personas before. And, you know, we don't spend an inordinate amount of time, but really, I just want to get into the head of the new leader in this organization. And so simple template to use when I'm working with my client, and this is something our L&D practitioners who are internals or externals can use, you know, learner resonance. What do we want our learners saying, doing, thinking, and feeling differently, right? And of course, this is then positioned next to what are those strategic levers that we're looking to move. Now it's what do we want our learners doing differently that's going to align and shift these levers out here. And this is done in partnership with my client. We usually will use like a Scrumbler board, which is a brainstorming board. Okay. If you're not familiar with Scrumbler, I'll put the link here in just a moment. But it's really a nice way to allow your client to help identify the say, do, think, feel differently. You know, and again, from there, here's another one of our personas that we've built. Cynthia, she's our mid-level leader. You know, she's different. Her goals are different. Her usage is different. You know, kind of the work she's doing is different. And her learning methods are a bit different based on what she's doing. So we've looked at the who. Now it's time to think about, you know, what are we trying to solve for? And based on the goals here of our leader, Cynthia or Elise, and understanding those strategic levers that we're looking to move, we really can identify what are the things that we're trying to solve for. The next thing I'll share is the experience. So, you know, how do we get from, okay, we need leaders who can build trust with their people and really have more effective conversations with their people. What does that actually look like? Well, of course, there's training on how do you build trust. A lot of people think, you're either trustworthy or you're not. It's actually not true. There is actually mindsets and skill sets that go along with the ability to be able to build trust with people, to restore trust when trust has been broken, and to get in front of trust eroding behaviors. So that's really important for right now. That's a big topic that's coming up a lot. But so building trust and communicating effectively through more meaningful conversations and productive conversations. So the journey framework, this is another tool that I'll share. And this basically, we've got 10 kind of distinct categories of things that we're thinking about when we're going to build out a journey for a client. You know, the first is, you know, creating the common language. What is our golden thread that needs to be woven through the experience? Are we looking at, you know, if we're building out, say, a 4-month journey, and we've got, you know, those formal moments of learning, say, on trust and on productive conversations. What are the golden threads outside of that, inclusivity and belonging, that we would want to weave through, maybe in scenarios? Perhaps in some try it activities that we would design for our clients, leaders, as they're going through the experience, that are really going to be focused in on that golden thread of inclusivity and belonging, right? So the common language, how are we going to target our people? What does the experience look like? How are we going to make sure it feels like home? It feels like what the client is expecting and what learners are hoping for a modern experience. Do we have an opportunity for them to self-assess before they start? You know, for us as L&D professionals, having a confidence and competence kind of an assessment, something that we would create to gauge how competent are they in these skills today, and what is their confidence level that they can actually do it, right? And so we use these indexes as a really great pre and post measure as well. And of course, each item is behavioral and skill-based. And when you look at the pre and post data on that, you're able to monetize the impact of that behavior change over time. So it really helps us get to what we need to be able to prove to our stakeholders and our leaders. How will we generate pull and push? How are we going to build connections, right? To create social elements that are woven into our learning experiences over time. You know, a lot of LXPs may have some social learning capability at different levels. Some is just commenting. Some allows commenting and reply. Some allows full discussion. So how do we create that connectivity?
Right.
Opportunities to reflect, make it real, keeping others informed. So the leaders of people going through the learning, right? Collecting data and measuring, and then making it easy. What are we going to do to make it easy for our learners? When we've got this kind of a map built out, maybe we're ready to go, right? But it's that deliberate thought on how these factors lead to the creation of a journey. And so I'll pause there. I'd love to see if we've got any questions from the group, or Chris, from you.
Yeah.
Questions or thoughts?
Yeah, well, we'll watch for the chat, any questions in the chat or in the actual question panel, if folks have it. On the previous slide, just something that maybe we can help clarify. This is still part of your information gathering and analysis phase. These aren't steps in a sequence.
Right,
at this point in time, right.
Mm-hmm.
Just making sure on that,
Yep, and so when I'm working with one of my clients, you know, typically our first step in an engagement is a collaborative design session where we're going to come together and we're going to do a good bit of this work. But my role as a solution architect is I'm going to do some good pre-thinking here. In order to do that, I need to know the learning technology that they've got in place. You know, what does the current L&D department look like? You know, what other content? Because they may have content, you know, you know, as much as I love for a full Blanchard journey, guess what? I love to be able to integrate things that they're already investing in that work well, and kind of being able to work that in. So I do some pre-work, Yes, you betcha, Summer. We're definitely going to share this stuff. It'll be in the LinkedIn community. We'll get a link to that at the end of the session, and they'll be posted there, a couple of good templates for you to use. But I'll do this upfront work. When we get into the collaborative design session with our client, we're kicking tires. We're confirming kind of our initial hypotheses that I would have come up with here, adding in new things that I just simply wasn't aware of because we hadn't begun the engagement yet. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right. So let's pop to the, to the actual journey.
Yes. So journeys look different client to client. They look very, very different. So depending on what the client has going on, depending on the timeline that they want for this journey and kind of organizational mandates, you know, in this last 18 months, we're getting a lot of clients who say, you know, we had to put a pause on things for obvious reasons, but now we're in a situation where we're growing and we're growing by acquisition and we need something quickly. And so they may need something that turns out in September or October, you know, or it may be, you know, a more, a little more time to that, but it always looks different. So this is an example of a blended journey that was created for a client that I work with. The large bubbles represent formal moments of learning. The small bubbles represent something that's happening kind of along the way, kind of that journey-based experience that's building and extending on these formal moments. The dark circles are content that the client already had, and guess what? It works and they love it. And it has a solid place and needs to remain in the journey. The aqua bubbles are bubbles that are Blanchard's content. So you can kind of see visually what the legend is. Our little dots that are happening in between is work that is happening along the way, assignments, activities, things that are bringing groups of people who are part of this cohort experience together in smaller groups to work on things that have to do with their real work. And so you can see as we kind of scoot across, starting a journey, most of these are largely virtual still. We do have some face-to-face, as I mentioned, it's coming back. This one was created about 6 months ago. But a custom welcome and a digital learning guide to really set the stage and a kickoff so that people come together and they know this is not a flash in the pan. This is something that is going to last the next 12 months. And they understand the expectations. Along the way, we see this little icon with these little two guys, these little two people. These are leader conversations that are happening along the way. And we're creating conversation guides for them. It makes it very easy for me as new leader to approach my leader and have a conversation so that I can learn about my leader's experience in a way that I don't have to work too hard to think of the questions and they're prompts that are going to really yield great, great dialogue. And I share that with leader so that leader knows, and there's no gotchas, no surprises. Leader can come prepared with really great examples to talk about. Okay. So that's one example of a journey. I've got a couple of others that I'll share. Again, the color schemes are different. Again, these are created for different clients, but I'll pause here. I'd love to see if anyone has any questions for me based on, you know, what you saw or what you're thinking about.
Mm-hmm. Well, certainly so far, there's lots of love in the chat.
Yay! I love love.
for what you're showing. Repeated over and over again, both with emojis and with words. So
yay. Well, then if there's no questions, we'll keep on rolling. This is Cynthia. So we saw Cynthia's persona earlier, right? Mid-level leader. And this is for a state government. And her journey looks a bit different. This client is looking for a 9-month journey. And they needed an experience that was tightly connected to their values. And so you can see this blue text in bold is where each of these formal moments of learning connect very closely to their values. So it needs to be a values-driven leadership development experience that's going to move the needle on employee engagement, okay? Here we see a couple of different things. So we've got, and I know that it's probably kind of small to see, but we use a legend over here so that they can see what are the modalities and the touch points for our people. And, you know, I'll talk about the modality here. This is a collaborative online experience. Not sure if anyone is familiar. I developed the map, actually. I build it. So it's just in PowerPoint. It's a simple slide. You can see kind of the the icons. I've got kind of my modality icons, and these look different. You know, typically I have a starting point when I'm talking to a client. I'm like, oh, I can use the journey that we created for X client as a really good starting point from a content and a modalities perspective. And then really I'm tweaking the legend, and I'm tweaking kind of where things are happening, durations as needed, and based on what the client's looking for.
Yeah. Julie's, Harold had asked the question, you know, how's the map developed? Julie is also asking, you know, how is it, are you developing this? I think what they're looking for is more like, how did we get to, you know, the parts of the, that we're showing on the journey here, which is, I mean, you were talking about creating the profiles.
Yeah.
And then the previous, then the slide after that, where we were looking at the framework of stuff. So you're coming from, you know, client conversations, client meetings, and gathering information, et cetera, to gather all of these pieces together. As we've been working through to get to this point so far in our in our conversation here today.
You betcha. So starting with persona, and I work with my client to, you know, just make sure that we're on the right track about what do these people's work experience look like? What is their day-to-day? What do they need to get done organizationally? What do we need to get them done? What do we need them to do? And then from here, as I'm building this out, based on the conversations with the client, you know, we've got a do as I say, not as I do culture, and we lack conversations that are productive, that build trust and really build good relationships so that the work can get done. And from there, I'm thinking about what are our Blanchard tools in the toolbox that we've got. And the modality selection is very much based on what the client has indicated. We want to have a global cohort. So we're going to have people from around the world who are going to be in this cohort together. So we're going to need to be able to support, in some cases, multi-language, in other cases, large cohort where lots of people can come together. And, you know, particularly, we've got a modality at Blanchard called collaborative online experiences. We use an LXP to develop this. And basically, it allows us to incorporate a ton of self-directed learning, infuse discussions and conversations that really build on what people are seeing and doing as they're applying what they've learned. It allows us to stage assignments that then are uploaded, and it has a robust social capability around assignments. And we've also created a badging construct that goes with that for digital credentialing, so that the learning that they're doing also has street value outside of say state of mind, that shows the kind of skills that Cynthia has that are absolutely portable in her career. Thank so it's kind of layering in a lot of different things, but the modality selection is very much based on where our audience is, kind of, are they on shift work? Are we gonna have multiple shifts coming together for an experience? And what could that look like to be, to create an experience that's resonant for all of them?
Yeah, and I mean, this particular example here, you said this is a 9-month process. And even just looking at, you know, the self-leadership, that's a 12-hour. The one below that is, you know, 10 to 15 hours of time. So this is not a small commitment or a small expectation for your learning audience. Let's talk a little bit about how you frame that up then for those. How do you get folks, you know, to buy in on this long-term thing, and what they're, you know, how to set their expectations as learners?
Yeah, for sure. I've got another journey with a client that's 4 months and it's light. You know, a couple of small digital pieces, 25 minutes a piece, focused very specifically again on target skills and that they want their people to develop. So there starts with two kind of short form digital courses. And then they go into a 2-day live, which, you know, we were very intrigued. This is one of my first clients. It's going back to a face-to-face model, but they wanted 2 days of live leadership development woven into what is already a 4-day experience. And then they wanted some things along the way. So their total seat time over the course of 7 months is really like less than 20 hours. So it depends. And I, you know, coming out of the gate for an experience, a journey like this, this is a lot of time and a lot of commitment. And before I pitch something like this, I'm going to be real clear on what the thresholds are. You know, what is the current leadership development that's happening today? What are the total number of hours that the organization, the aptitude of the number of hours that is going to land well? Because if I come in with a journey like this for a client that they're going from, say, 2 half-day virtual sessions, they're going to move it along. And so I'm really mindful of how we pull the right content, the right modality, to make sure that, as our senior sales leader says, she goes, it's got to fit in the bread box. Mm-hmm. And so you need to know what that bread box is in number of hours and in level of investment for those of you who are external consultants as well. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Jill is asking in the chat, any tips for making collaborative learning authentic and creating value with it for learners versus just another task to post and respond?
You know, for us and for our collaborative online experiences, people will say that they loved it because they really felt connected. There's a couple of things. It's got to have the self-directed element. It's got to be so relevant to me and my role in my world. And at Blanchard, our content, you know, really we focus in as much as how is this going to make you more effective at work, as how is it going to make you more effective as a human being? And so if you can think about those kinds of hooks in other content, you know, whether it's, you know, customer care, philosophy training, and really being able to connect to what people are going through when they need help, or being able to help others outside of work with the learning that you're building. So we have a lot of very interpersonal hooks in our learning so that the tools that they're getting are applicable today at work, like immediately today, but they're also applicable as soon as my kids get home from school, like when they go back to school, right? So that's one. So making it very, very relevant to the whole human being. The next is incorporating activities that are easy for them to apply. Like they can, their next assignment, they can do it in their very next conversation with someone who reports to them. That's the next thing, is activities that are immediately applicable and easy to apply. Because if we make the barrier to engage with our content too difficult, people won't use it. And then the third is the social element. So it's not just you have to post on this. Yeah. Typically, our social forums, those are optional points. We're not going to make that required.
Okay.
Not going to make it required. And then the fourth thing is, each week of experience, we punctuate with a live event. And so you're coming together with this great global community, and it's not a rehash of what you learned. It's actually talking about what this looks like in your world and learning from other folks who are applying, and what are some of the pearls that you could take away after that live session to be able to do things differently. So that's kind of how we think about that collaborative, kind of self-directed global cohort type of experience.
Yeah, I think hopefully, Jill, that gives you some ideas around that. I kind of know where Jill is coming from. I've done some online coursework where, you know, there's a discussion board or whatever, and it kind of feels like you're rushing to be the first to post in so that you can get something, you know, done. And then after that, you folks are going, yes, I agree. You know, very basic kind of, you know, interaction within that kind of a structure. So I kind of, I can feel Jill's question there.
Yeah.
yeah. Sometimes we have these tools, but they don't do what we actually end up, wanting them to do. So.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, I see a good question from Sabrina, and you've got a real challenge there. So, you know, part-time staff, high level of turnover. How do we track progress? You know, how do we manage that people are being hired day to day? Reminds me of an experience that I had working for a large telecom a number of years ago. It was largely face-to-face, but if I were to think about what that would look like in this kind of a construct, we were hiring temps, you know, so we had people coming in on a Tuesday, coming in Thursday, you know, it was a hard structure to manage. Here, I would create largely a self-directed journey, but I would punctuate with a lot of leader and new hire conversations so that there is that constant connection that is happening along the way. So there's some accountability there. It's really easy when we've got a full self-directed journey that there's limited accountability. And we want accountability on the part of the leader, making sure that their people are getting the skills that they need and the training that they need. And we also want accountability on the part of the learner to learn the things that they're supposed to in that sequence. So if you did it self-directed, let's say in your LMS, you set it up as a curriculum structure with prerequisites, and maybe those leader conversations are attestations along the way. So you could have kind of formal moment of learning, like a course, and then perhaps like a try it activity that they are going to try, maybe with their team leader. And then they acknowledge that, maybe put in a few notes, a narrative, if your technology supports it. And perhaps I would also think about creating maybe like a, if you've got MS Teams, like a, you know, a team site for people who are in the experience, regardless of where they are. And then you can have some discussion threads that are specific to different points along the way, you know, and that's a neat way to be able to manage that. That's kind of off the top of my head what I would think.
Very cool. Very cool. Improvising on the spot answers and solutions for folks. Brilliant. Michelle's asking, can you go back to slide 7 for a minute, which was slide 7. And then Michelle, what follows from your mind then, Michelle, about slide 7 there? Give you a heartbeat to type in there. A question then, how many profiles do you generally sort of look to set up or create before going further past that profiling stage or the persona stage? Sorry,
for the personas. For the personas, you know, typically for first conversations, early conversations, we'll do one, but then it's almost the creating a variant, you know, making sure that on the bell curve, Cynthia's persona is really darn close, right? Okay. If we're talking about, I've got a number of clients who, you know, I've got new leaders who, some are in the warehouse, some are in the field, some are in the administrative offices of our organization. Their work environment looks very different. And so how does this land across? And the design point there, the design question there is, you know, do we create variants or do we create on the bell curve a singular experience that is going to meet the needs of all three? And managing three separate journeys for people who are in different places in time is really difficult. And so typically we'll encourage, let's get tight on a singular journey that's going to meet the needs of these three learners. And then what that means is we've got to do a really good job at setting expectations for learners because it's going to be new to them, and doing a really good job at preparing the leaders of the learners for what this experience is, the investment, the movement of the needles that we're anticipating, and how we need them to help. And so a lot of times getting the right level of involvement to create something like this and stand it up, it is a defining criteria that without it, you know, it's just going to be in 6 months, you're going to be talking about why things didn't work. And so doing a lot of that really good stakeholder involvement engagement very early.
Julie's asked a question in the chat. How do you use the profiles in an ongoing way for things like team building?
Oh, that's an awesome question. So for us, the personas actually can be used for lots of things. Certainly they could be used for kind of planning any kind of development work that you're going to be doing. They could be used for other activities that are happening in the organization, like the marketing department, corporate communications can use them, you know, but it's having enough personas that span kind of what you would need, kind of the purpose. Yeah, I worked with a large automotive client in Germany, and they built out their personas and their marketing department grabbed them because they said, we can use these to help us shape and frame, you know, all of our internal employee communications that we put out, all of our sales documentation and support, because, you know, just looking at these different personas, it turns out that without these, we actually were really only developing for one, and we've got, you know, tens of thousands of employees around the globe. And that kind of helped to open their eyes on how they could communicate better organizationally.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Very cool. Yeah. Let's talk a bit more, I guess, about measurement. You mentioned it earlier, you know, being prepared to measure these sorts of things as you go. And one of the questions I always have is about these kind of, the generic term of soft skills, you know, et cetera, but, you know, measuring those kinds of behavioral changes and the impact then on the organization.
Yeah, that's a great question. Hold on a second. I am going to, and you guys are going to see all of my crazy stuff that I've got. Oh, goodies for IDIODC. Let's see. Da, 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 da. Let me, is it here? It's not here. You know what? Let me stop sharing my screen for just one moment.
Yeah, so, no worries.
Yeah.
Or even just talking about it in a general way as we.
Yeah, for sure. So we have five critical success factors. Measurement is one of them. Stakeholder buy-in is another. So I've talked about how critical it is for us to have the stakeholder buy-in. And without that, you know, we end up in kind of a bind. But measurement is another one of them. And actually, let me go ahead and share my screen. I've got it here. So this is something that you know, we often talk about and think about, but seeing it laid out in this way, key influencer buy-in. So we talked about that. That's at the senior levels, but that's also at the learner leader level as well. Strategic integration, making sure that we're aligned with organizational objectives. That's another one, right? Those golden threads, the strategic levers we've got to move, right? Demonstrating tangible value. And so at the start, it's thinking about, again, when we have the conversation, the levers that we're moving, what are the behaviors that are going to create that movement? What are the skills? And then what is the learning? So that initial thought process, because oftentimes people will say, well, we need training on communication skills and business acumen, right? Well, what does that actually look like? And what does this have to do with the big picture? And a lot of times, you know, in L&D orgs, they're responding to so many requests and needs around the organization that just taking that moment to step it back a little bit. And then once we really get to, you know, what is the lack of business acumen doing? What will it look like when people can do this well? Then it's that next level is, what does our confidence and competence capability and index look like before learning? What does it look like after learning? And are there subsets of the employee engagement survey or the employee experience survey that we can actually redeploy over time where we should see movement if we've done a great job, which we expect to see movement, right? And so those are kind of the things that we think about very, very early on. So
yeah, making sure that your measurement strategy, et cetera, always, it needs to be part of the start rather
up front.
Than, crumb. Now let's measure. We don't know.
Yeah, that's exactly right. It's like writing an assessment in an e-learning course, you know, after you've created the course. No. The assessment is the first thing you write. It's the first thing you write. And then you build the course to the assessment, because that's what you want people to be able to demonstrate and do differently. Yep. This is very much the same. Yep.
Rick's noting in the chat there, what will it look like when people can do this well is a golden question. It helps determine what kind of intervention or strategies we need to bring forward as part of a solution.
Yep, that is excellent. Yep, good point. There are two questions. I know we're coming to the close of our time, but there were a few questions that I saw. First of all, on a journey, can someone self-select out? Does someone have to go through all of this? You know, and in some cases, it may be a journey that's like the main line that all new leaders need to go through this. But if someone has already gone through, let's say they've already completed building trust in SL2 because we were doing some kind of disparate things, you know, before we really got our arms and our minds around this needs to be something bigger than just an event-based experience. You know, certainly at that point, you can think about a subset of learners that maybe doesn't need to complete the entire journey. But in terms of a full self-selection, it gets really hard for us to prove the needle moving when people are able to have full control over self-serve. So that's one question. The second question that I saw is, what about CEUs, continuing education?
Right.
You know, we work with a lot of clients in the medical field and healthcare fields and, you know, clinicians who need CEUs. And absolutely, we've done the work where looking at the programming, what does this look like from a CEU perspective? Yep. It's kind of another layer that, you know, we don't get asked for on every engagement or even many engagements, but certainly something like this could be distilled for CEU purposes.
Mm-hmm. For sure. And that's part of the conversation as you're getting started, being aware of the context, et cetera, that both organizationally, but even as individual learners, their own expectation of, if I'm doing this, can I also get the other credit for it too, as we go along?
Yes. Yes, exactly. Exactly.
Yeah.
Great.
So Anne, you are taking some of this forward, and you mentioned your ATD session.
Yes.
Up. Yes. I think you've probably got that handy if you want to go ahead and paste that in.
Oh, for sure.
And any other contact info, I'm going to get the music rolling here. We have reached our time. This has been a fabulous conversation here today.
Great.
So much going on. We will be posting the resources in the LinkedIn as well as on our Domino blog summary of today's session. So watch for that info, folks. There's your contact info. I'll paste in the LinkedIn LinkedIn URL one more time. Nope, that's not it. Let me get it. Do my own copy pasting. I'm not used to doing all of the things usually. Brent and I kind of split some of these things up. So there we go. There's the LinkedIn. If you haven't joined us already, go in there and connect with us there. We'll have the resources posted there. Gang, thanks so much for your chat questions today. Been absolutely great. And thank you so much for bringing all of this forward to us and helping us get this or wrap our brains around this idea then of a learning journey.
Yes, awesome.
Yeah, and folks, make sure that if you are going to ATD, you do check out Anne's session to get even more helpful info around all of this stuff. And in the meantime, gang, let's dance on out of here. Happy Wednesday, folks. And have a great time, and we'll see you again next week, gang. Thanks, everybody.
Bye, everybody.